Hey everyone, it's Neal here today with channelfireball.com with another draft for you. This time we're doing a Ravnica flashback draft. I'll make these cards a little bit bigger for you. So this pack has Devouring Light, which is a great removal spell, and it has, I guess, Sunholm, Siege Worm, Thundersong Trumpeter. I think those are the best cards in this pack. I like to not start with a double color card, if possible, unless it's a really, really good one. There are some good ones that are worth first picking, like, I'm forgetting the name of it, Ribbons of Night. It's essentially, like, blue-black gold card. Some of the higher rarity cards, like Glare of Subdual is a bomb in this format, things like that are worth picking early. But starting with a really, really powerful single colored removal spell that's flexible, I'm perfectly happy to do it. Also goes in multiple archetypes, because when you're drafting triple Ravnica, you have the four guilds. So you have Boros, Selesnya, Golgari, and Dimir. So anytime you can basically start with a card that can go in multiple guilds, it's pretty powerful. Although Boros is pretty, I think, is clearly the worst. I think it goes, you have Dimir and Celestia on top, and depending which one's like more open, that can dictate which is the most powerful in your seat. And then Golgari, I think, is clearly second to worst, and then Boros at the bottom. It's pretty much the power order on those cards. So here, there's Birds of Paradise, which is a pretty good card, and V2 Ghazi, which can take over games by itself. Both of them put me into green after taking this card. Birds is a little more flexible, because if I don't play Devouring Light, I can still play Birds and Golgari. I think V2 Ghazi is a bit more powerful than Birds. Birds mostly just mana fixes. Well, I guess that's exactly what it does, but it's kind of replaceable with Signets and things in this format. So I think V2 Ghazi is actually the card I want to take here. Galvanic Arc is the best card here, and it's not particularly close. You can kind of think of this as just a removal spell, but it has the upside of being able to be bounced by different things like Drake Familiar. You can Flicker Form this card, which lets it blink back and forth and keep triggering. There are other ways to find it. There's like a rare and an uncommon that can find Galvanic Arc from your deck. It's one of the few good red commons in the set, and gonna pick it here. If anything, I could always splash it in a green-white deck, because I just think that Boros is quite bad, as I was saying. It also works pretty well with some of the other Enchantment Matters cards in the set, like Bramble Elemental, which can put a bunch of 1-1s into play. So if you get Galvanic Arc going with Bramble Elemental, that's very good, although kind of hard to do, seeing as they don't have a guild overlap. But I do find that drafting Naya is fine sometimes in this set. So you just overlap your guilds. So cards that are calling to me here are like Flight of Fancy, which goes with the Aura sub-theme, but it's not a super powerful card. Veteran Armor, which is actually pretty annoying. There's a bunch of ways to go wide with tokens. So this can actually beef up enough of your creatures to the point that you get really, really good double, triple blocks, etc. And it's just a cheap card that can enable Convoke, which is pretty important. It's one of the few good 2-drops I would want to play in a lot of my more aggressive shells. Junk Troller is actually pretty good in the format. It's just a big wall. It helps prevent milling from Dimir to some extent. But I think our deck is mid-range to point, and also probably wanting it to be white because of V2 Ghazi and Devouring Light, that I'll take Veteran Armor over it. Well, Stinkweed Imp is by far the best card in the pack. Basically just able to take down anything, and you just get to keep bringing it back over and over again, which is incredibly annoying. Doesn't really go with our cards at all, although I could be Celestia Golgari if I take the Stinkweed Imp. There's also Fist of Ironwood, which works well if I'm going Celestia, and works with the Galvanic Arc. I could give up everything entirely and just take this card. It's a bit of a sign. I think Fist of Ironwood is not anywhere near as close to good as Stinkweed Ebb. There's also Transluminant for the deck we're drafting right now. But I think I'm just going to take the most powerful card. And if Stinkweed Ebb doesn't pan out, then I can just give it up, and that's fine. But this might be my opportunity to pivot into either Dimir or Golgari. So the best cards in this pack, Dark Blast, Halcyon Glaze, and Snapping Drake. Really the only playables for the most part. Sometimes Sewer Drake is good because two of the guilds have swamps in them, so you know that could be effective. But that's more of a board plan than anything else. I think of these, I'm going to take Dark Blast. It's a pretty reasonable effect, and there's a lot of annoying 1/1s and 2/2s. You can sometimes upkeep this and then redraw it and then play it again to take care of 2/2s if you want to, like any of the guild mages. So I'll take that because we took Stinkweed in last pick, and I don't know if I'm going to be like blue-black or playing this in like a white-green-black shell, an Abzan shell. All right, so here's Aura Touch Mage. This is the uncommon I was referencing earlier when I was saying it can get a Galvanic Arc. So this just comes into play, and you get to put Galvanic Arc right on it and burn something for 3, which is pretty sweet. There's also some other enchantments. We saw the Fist of Ironwood to get some 1/1s. That can work with this guy as well. There's also Pollen Bright Wings, which is one of the better combos with this. It's a 6-mana aura you can put on it that basically gives it flying and makes a bunch of sapperlings, which is very effective. I just really like this card. Drafting around it's a lot of fun, and it could good. Well, now that I just took Aura Touch Mage, I can pick up auras a little more highly. This pack has a really aggressive red card, which I'm not really into drafting. A couple good blue cards. This is a combo card with all the auras, which actually works out pretty well in this format. It's kind of almost a blue-red card, even though Izzet is not in this set. And Drift of Phantasms, which is just extremely flexible and makes it really hard for anyone to ever attack. But I'm going to take Strands of Undeath and see where that goes. I guess Sunhome Wield is one of the better cards in the pack. I'm going to take it over Ordruin Commando. Small chance I splash like Sunhome and Galvanic Arc in red. These cards are all pretty bad. This is pretty much a glorified Stormcrow, which I'm not really interested in. I think I'm going to take Sewer Drag for the reasoning I mentioned earlier. It's a reasonable sideboard card. Spelunkerers, if I end up red enough, this is a good sideboard card as well for similar reasons. This card's actually just pretty good. Just deals them some damage and makes you not take any. I think Leave No Trace is a little better as a sideboard card than Boros Recruit. I got one anyways. So I'm in a kind of a weird spot right now. I was thinking I might lean Celestia, but then I didn't actually get any green cards. But I'm really just like white, black, splash, red. Which actually might work out fine, because I could just be a white, black deck and pick up some Boros Fixing. And just play a lot of Plains and Swamps. I don't get any good gold cards if that happens, but if we open up just a bunch of good monocolored cards, then that's just fine. Speaking of which, Hex is one of the best cards that you can reasonably open. It does have the drawback that you can't just cast this to kill like 4 creatures. You do have to target 6. This card's incredible. If I just have 1 creature out of my opponent's 5, I just get to plague wind them for 6 mana. Sure, I have to kill my own, but that's certainly worth doing. Nothing in this pack is even remotely close to as powerful. And this pack's also pretty weak, so I don't think we're going to realistically wheel anything from it. There's like a Boros Signet, Disembowel, Flight of Fancy, Benevolent Ancestor's okay, but the lands are fine. But everything else is pretty medium. So it's kind of cool. When you do these flashback drafts, you're trying to basically figure everything out on the fly. I have the benefit that this is maybe like my 10th Ravnica draft I've done during this cycle, like 10 in a week, which is a lot more than I've done of some of the other flashback drafts, just because I find it actually pretty fun and interesting, and something that I haven't really drafted before much of, because I didn't draft the set that much when it first released. But there's all these like intricate sub-archetypes, and I've never drafted anything quite like this, where I'm not quite in a guild yet, and yet we have a lot of cool synergies and things happening. So excited to see where that goes. Flicker Form is a card I was mentioning earlier that combos well with Galvanic Arc and Strands of Undeath, because you can put this on your creature, and it flickers the auras as well as the creature. You can also put this on opposing creatures, so that if you just want to like get rid of them, like they play a big bomb, and you just, you know, basically remove it from the game every single turn. So it's pretty versatile and quite powerful. So I'm going to be happy to pick that up here. It also works incredibly well with Aura Touch Mage, because every time it comes back in, you get an additional aura, not to mention all the other auras that are already attached to it. So it goes crazy. Like, I can just find Flicker Form the first time with Aura Touch Mage, and then on the second blinks, I can go and get the other auras in my deck. So there's another Stinkweed Imp, but there's also a Boros Garrison. This is a pretty close pick. I only have three creatures right now, which is not very many, so the Stinkweed Imp is seeming pretty nice, just to make it hard for opponents to attack us. The bounce lines are really high picks, though, because they basically can help you unmulligan, and it provides fixing at the same time, and it's card advantage. And this card doesn't really look like it belongs right now. I'm a little low on playables. I really don't know what to do here. Stinkweed Imp does have the benefit of having my opponents try to play a bunch of creatures to go around it, which sets up Hex pretty nicely. But I think I should probably take the Garrison. I just don't have any bounce lines yet, and I think they're pretty important. Another Dark Blast. Thundersong Trumpeter, a nice splash card. There's also random, basically, Grizzly Bear that we could play. Don't really want to do that. I think I'm just going to take this Thundersong Trumpeter. If I pick up a little more fixing, I can realistically splash it, and it has a unique effect on the game. It can be very aggressive or defensive. In this deck, it's going to be more defensive, but it could be good. All right, so this is very good in our deck, helps protect us. And it's a big wall that, again, incentivizes our opponents to try to play a bunch of things to race it, and then we just hex them out of the game. The Dalton Transfer is one of the best commons in the set. Just mills people out at a ridiculously fast rate. Unfortunately, we're not in that deck, so we can't pick it, but I'm happy with this. Sad we're not in blue, but such is life. Alright, this card is just totally fine, totally reasonable. Creatures are pretty small in this set, so 2-1 first strike actually battles pretty well, and so then this actually works quite well on offense and defense, more than you would think at first glance. Okay, so there's essentially a Gravedigger, except the opponent gets to choose, and Clinging Darkness, which can deal with some problem creatures, especially bigger things that your deck can't normally handle. This deck actually has a reasonable amount of removal already, though, and has Stinkweed Imp for big things, and Strands of Undeath to help regenerate if they have a big ground attacker that doesn't have trample. So I think I'm much more interested in this turnkey. Not having to dredge the Stinkweed Imp is pretty nice, because dredge 5 is a lot. And if my opponent ever kills some of these other creatures I care about, or maybe mills something I care about, then I can just get it back. Okay, certainly nothing amazing here for us. Could take this if my opponent has some annoying flyers. At least have something to maybe block them, because most of the flyers are small. But two toughness is probably not enough to really handle those, unless I somehow buff up my Courier Hawk, which is unlikely to happen. Coal Hauler Swine's not very good for us, though. It's a small chance I play Fist of Ironwood if I get just infinite fickling. I also have this V2 Ghazi. I think this was our pack that we opened, and surprisingly there are still some of the better... Not better, but still some playables in this pack. Which... I didn't think would happen. This card's good on evasive creatures to get back more threats. It's not great in our deck, though. I could take Flight of Fancy to splash. I think I'm going to do that. Probably not actually going to splash it, but it's an option. Alright, I'll play another Ancestor. Take some random card. This card actually performs much better than it looks. I mean, it's an 0-4 wall, but preventing one, again, a lot of the creatures are small in the set, so that works nicely. It also stacks well against some of the bigger creatures. One of the big ways Celestia wins is has a 4/7 vigilance creature, so this can straight up block that creature and prevent one to itself, which just neutralizes that 8 mana threat all by itself. Spark Mage Apprentice, also good with Flicker Form, and if our opponents have any small creatures for us to destroy. These cards are all bad. Alright, so our deck still needs fixing. I'm really glad I took the Boros Garrison despite wanting another Stinky Nip, because I need to prioritize fixing pretty heavily this pack. I have, like, Sewer Drag I could play if I just need a playable. This is probably more of a sideboard card. Just because I'm not playing it on turn 2 very often, so I'm not getting rid of any utility creatures early. Most of the time. Let's see. Well, this pack is bad for us. For the most part. Brain Spoil is just a really expensive card. It's okay. It is unconditional removal most of the time, although enchantments come up much more frequently than you would think otherwise, just because there's a lot of enchantment sub-themes to the set. So this card gets better in the full block where there's fewer enchantments running around. I could take Dimir Signet just for some acceleration. Could randomly fix later. I could also take Lurking Informant. In any long game, this can kind of take over. It fixes draw steps for us and just basically plays Lantern Control, keeps our opponents on all lands on the top of their decks if it's working right. So I think I could actually first pick this and be reasonably happy with it. Our deck is just not particularly fast, so once we have it locked up, it's going to provide some uses. Boros Signet seems good. I've played with this card a reasonable amount. It's basically just turn against. But it always performs worse than I expect it to, because there are so many big toughness creatures in the format that it's really hard to get a 2-for-1 with this card. And so I remember it being better, but I think, again, maybe in full block where everyone's playing a bunch of different guilds, and I don't really know. My expectation of the card is better than it actually plays out. Maybe that's just small sample size. Anyway, I was pretty happy with the Signet here. Could also take Sanctuary to try to splash V2 Ghazi, but I think right now I'm trying to just fix the deck we already have. The mana we already have. Another Galvanic Arc is fantastic. Really, I just want one more Aura Touch Mage, then we have the Dream Deck. Just always flicker forming everything and going right off. Sins of the Past is pretty nice sometimes. You get to recast an instant or sorcery. The problem is my best instant or sorcery hex pretty much ends the game anytime it gets cast, so I don't really need to cast Hex twice. There's just not enough creatures where that's ever a thing. Razia, Boros, Archangel. That's a win condition. 8 mana. Red, red, white, white. I don't know if it's better than taking a bounce land here. It does give me a card where if I'm flooding out, I just play Razi and win. But my mana is kind of horrible right now. So I'm tempted to just take the Garrison. Already have a lot of value. I think I'm going to take this Garrison and hope for the best. Not sure if it's a mistake or not. Alright, we've done it. So now we have win conditions. Got two Aura Touch Mages with a bunch of enchantments that are just going to end the game on their own, so glad I didn't take the Razia then. Seed Spark can provide some outs to trouble permanents. Sadistic Augur Mage is just a blocker. Not sure which I want more. I already have Leave No Trace to destroy enchantments, which pretty much just works better than Seed Spark because we don't have the green kicker. And I might need playables. I think I'm just going to take a random 3-1. Ooh, another Boros Signet. Okay. Now our deck has ample fixing. And that's fantastic. I might even be able to play the Sunholm. Although, double strike in this deck just is not that impressive. Mindmoil is an interesting card. My deck tops out at 5 or 6 mana, and I have cards I really want to find. So I think Mindmoil is a pretty good splash card. You basically just get to cycle through your deck really, really quickly. Playing one spell at a time. It also turns these like redundant signets into spells that can draw into a bunch of new ones later on so that they're not just useless mana. Mindmoil is kind of the perfect card for the deck. Screeching Griffin can be fine. Oh, another bounce land. Probably would play three. It only makes green randomly, but so I can either have a 3-2 blocker out of the board or an anti-Celestia card. I think I already have a bunch of O4s, so I think Reign of Embers does more. Kind of close to just playing this. So I don't think I really need it, so I have enough other ways to use my mana a bunch. Mostly just thanks to Flicker Form. Like, this is my engine that's going to end most of the games. I could easily run 16 lands in this deck with 2 Signets. That's still 18 mana sources, 3 of which are bounce lands. This card's not very good against me. Also, I don't think I'll board it in very often, so I think I'll just take the Seeds of Strength. I already have a Slash right on the board. I'll just take this LD spell. Pass all the aggressive one-drop red cards to our left, if they can use them, cool. I'd rather not get our bounce lands destroyed, even though I don't think that's particularly good. Certainly could be annoying. So right now I could add 14 lands, so that would be 17. So I could play one more spell if I want it. Most of them are not particularly good. I could main deck a Goblin Spelunkerers. I could main deck a Spark Mage Apprentice. Like I said, it's good with Flicker Form. And it can combo with Galvanic Arc on turn 5 to take down a 4 toughness creature, of which there are many in the format, including Vedalken Entrancer, which is a bit annoying, as I was mentioning earlier. So I guess, let me put this here. It also can combo with Dark Blast, take down 2/2. So, like, it does have uses in the deck. C-Snid, so to speak, a 5-mana 3-3 kind of random card. Doesn't seem the best here. But 3-3 is still sizable. And like I said, almost half the table is going to be playing black, because Dimir is one of the better archetypes. So you're usually going to have 2 to 2.5 Dimir players, and then you have 1 to 1.5 Golgari players. So main decking a random swamp walk creature isn't that bad. Let's see, so if I do this, I get 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 white sources. I'm fine with 9 or 8. Let's look at 8 first. So this would be 6 black sources, which is clearly bad. I need like 8 black sources probably, which would give me 1, 2, 3, 4, 6 red sources. So 8, 8, 6. It's not great. I could play 17 lands. I have Mind Moil to help prevent flooding, and I have Flicker Form anytime I draw an Aura Touch Mage to also prevent flooding. So 17 lands with 2 bounce lands. I could also cut Celestia's Sanctuary, and that way I'm just playing 2 on color bounce lands if I don't need that much mana. The bounce lines let you just keep a wider range of hands, though, so I think playing the extra bounce line is still just fine. I could bump it up to 8-8-7 if I play an extra land, and I cut, like, the Sewer Dreg. If I do this, then this would be our deck. And well, 887 is not the best mana base. It's not embarrassing. I still have enough early red for these 2 and 3 drops. Plus, in a way, Mind Moil can kind of fix your colors, even though it's slow. I don't have very many double costs. Devouring Light I can cast off a single planes, as long as I have a white creature. Hex is turn 6. So 887 actually just not that bad of a mana base. 1, 2, 3, 4. Not sure if it gives us enough white. I could 9, 8, 6 instead. My main problem is these creatures, like with 7 mountains, I'm actually able to cast these early enough. Yeah, I think I'm going to run it like this. Alright. I'll see you in round 1.